But we've told you before about something called BDS. It stands for Boycott, Divestment, and Sanctions. If you haven't been following current events, you'd say, oh, that's probably a good idea. Maybe we should boycott Chinese products because of their attacks on democracy, or maybe we should have sanctions against Iran for their treatment of minorities. We should have sanctions against their oil. No. You think that's what it's about? You think it's about North Korea? No. BDS is about, well, it's the 21st century version of the original German boycott against the Jews. In the German language in the 1930s and 40s in Germany, it was Kauft nicht bei Juden. And you would have Nazis standing outside Jewish stores and say, don't buy from them. That's what has been reborn as the BDS movement of our age. And it's not some marginal fringe done by Nazis. It has been done by those in the corridors of power, including the United Nations itself, which is expected to come up with some sort of a hit list of companies that dare to do business with Jews. Now, not Jews in New York or in Toronto, but Jews in Israel, and in particular in Judea and Samaria, those parts of the West Bank that are Jewish land and under the control of the Israeli government. So what can companies do if they are targeted by this new blacklist, this new Don't Buy From Jews campaign? And what can they do if skillful NGOs, activists, and other pressure groups try and bully them out of doing business in Israel? Well, our next guest may have an answer. And in fact, he's gone forward putting together a legal brief to help protect companies against this kind of blacklisting pressure. Joining us now via Skype from New York is Benjamin Ryberg, the Director of Research for the Lawfare Project. Benjamin, nice to see you. Thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you so much for having me, Ezra.
Well, it's a pleasure. We know Brooke Goldstein of the Lawfare Project. She's one of our favorite people. You work with her as the director of research. Tell me first about what we expect the United Nations to say this year. The United Nations doesn't have time to take on the truly evil countries in the world, from North Korea to China to Iran to even Putin's latest predations, but they sure have time to focus on Israel. What are you expecting them to do later this year in terms of bullying companies like Airbnb and other companies that do business in the West Bank?
Right. So with respect to the UN Human Rights Council in particular, they have renewed efforts to produce a so-called blacklist of companies that are doing business in the Israeli-controlled territories. Again, as you mentioned, this includes Airbnb, Priceline.com, TripAdvisor, and some others, although this is all reported right now. The list, as far as we are aware, has not been finalized. And the UN Human Rights Council is claiming that it is producing this blacklist to be informational for travelers, for consumers, et cetera. The real reason is very clear to us. It is to attempt to coerce these entities either to stop their operations in the disputed territories or to stop working with Israel, or more so, we see it as an attempt to prompt other entities, other companies, and indeed consumers to boycott these companies by alleging that their mere operations in the disputed territories are somehow violations of international law.
Yeah.
Now, after you.
Well, thanks. You know what? I was just going to say that sounds familiar. We were the subject of this sort of smear campaign, deplatforming. We had a company cruise scheduled with Norwegian Cruise Line, and a bunch of extremist leftists managed to bully Norwegian Cruise Line, a very large cruise company, to ripping up $250,000 cruise contract with us, where we were going to have 100 or more people on. That kind of pressure tactic, that was from a left-wing NGO. But I can imagine if the United Nations itself, even a disreputable, discredited branch of the UN, like the Human Rights Council, where the Saudis and the Iranians have the run of the place, if the United Nations pressured Airbnb, Priceline, Caterpillar, these other companies, I would imagine it would be enormously difficult for them to continue. And they would feel panicked. They would say, well, if the United Nations is demonizing us, maybe we'd better get out.
You know, it's unclear. It is possible. Certainly, there are a lot of people out there who, I would say, do not have the background that I and the Lawfare Project have, or that you, frankly, have regarding the UN Human Rights Council and their extremely biased and indeed obsessive focus on all things Israel-related, to the detriment of the egregious human rights abuses being committed around the world, I should add. But, you know, it remains to be seen. If the UN produces a list And that's where it ends. And there is no blowback from other companies or consumers against these targeted entities. It may make no difference. They may be able to just brush it off. What I do think is of crucial importance, though, is that the targeted companies be aware of their legal rights, either if they are targeted with boycotts or if they are urged to withdraw from Israeli operations or boycott other Israeli entities. They need to be very aware of the various relevant laws that are available to them. Laws, A, that would enable them to potentially sue entities that boycott them based on their dealings with Israel, and even propose legislation. For example, the Israel Anti-Boycott Act, which is currently pending in the Senate, it specifically says you U.S. companies cannot participate in boycotts based on national origin, for instance, sponsored by intergovernmental organizations like the UN. Mm-hmm. So it's of absolute crucial importance, and I can't stress this enough, that these targeted companies know that there are legal avenues that they can pursue if they are harmed economically or even pushed by their shareholders, by consumers, by anybody else to get on board with what is frankly no more than bigoted discrimination against Israelis.
Yeah. America has some interesting laws about how Americans or even foreign countries should deal around the world. I'm thinking of the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, which is such a tough piece of legislation. It basically outlaws bribery around the world. And it's called the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. So if you're an American executive and you want to pay a bribe in India or some other country to get something going, you are in extreme peril back in America. If you or your company has any ties to America, if you're an American stock exchange, you and your company can be fined huge amounts. It's America trying to rid the world of corruption. You say you've put together a legal brief suitable for Airbnb, Priceline, Caterpillar, these other countries that are being pushed around. Can you tell me what the legal basis for them to resist this form of corruption, this form of, they're basically being bullied into discriminating against Israel? It's probably not the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, but tell me, if you can, one or two examples of legal authority in your briefing book that you've put together for these companies. Give me a one-liner how these companies could say, well, no, actually, we're not going to boycott Israel. That would be illegal because of A, B, and C.
Correct. So I will give you the boiled down version of this because the memorandum itself is quite lengthy. But essentially, we have a number of different laws, most notably the Export Administration Act of 1977, which was passed into law expressly because of the Arab League boycott of Israel, of Jews, of Jewish businesses, etc. And that law makes it unlawful for American entities, American businesses, to participate, to cooperate with, or to even furnish information in furtherance of a boycott of another entity because of its national origin. So what this says is, I'll give you an example. If a Saudi company calls up my U.S. company and says, we want you to give us information showing that you're not working with any Israeli entity because otherwise we're not going to do business with you, I might feel pressured because I want to do business with that Saudi company. But at the same time, if I do furnish that requested information, knowing what it is to be used for, I am breaking U.S. federal law and risking substantial penalties. So again, these companies need to be aware of this so that, let's say, at their board meeting, a BDS-related boycott proposal is brought up. They can quickly say to the meeting, say to their shareholders and their officers and directors, you know what, we shouldn't even be entertaining this, implementing any kind of BDS-related discriminatory business practices, because if we do, we could be liable under XYZ laws. Mm-hmm. That would be a violation of fiduciary duty. We could get sued in any number of ways. So anyway, I gave a longer answer to the EAA, Export Administration Act, than I had intended.
No, that's a great example. It's a great example. You know, I'm thinking of this. I'm Jewish myself, and so I don't like these Arab boycotts of Israel. But you know, I try and think of the example. I mean, I love Italians. I love Italian food. I love Italian. In another life, I wish I were Italian. Maybe I was. But I think if people everywhere they went were angry about Italy and hated Italy and wanted to boycott Italy and didn't like Italy, you'd say, well, do you have a real grievance with Italy, or are you just crazy? Are you just an Italy hater? And so if there was this madness to boycott, to delegitimize, to bring sanctions against Italy. And you can criticize, I'm just using Italy as an example. But I'm saying if you were some manic, crazy person who wouldn't shut up about Italy, and I'm not saying you can't criticize the Italian government. I'm sure there's 10 things I could really think about that I could criticize the Italian government about. But if you were just some crazy anti-Italy nut bar, and people were trying to pressure you to put corporate sanctions on Italy and trying to stop you from selling Italian food in the supermarket or buy Italian goods, it would be, first of all, we would call those people bigoted. We would probably call them unhinged. And if there were some real economic sanctions being proposed, you could see why, you know, you would want to use this kind of legislation to fight back. And this is not just a Jewish thing. It's because the Jews are being targeted here. But I believe that would apply, for example, if they tried to pick on Taiwan, a little country that's bullied by China. Now, there is no BDS move against Taiwan as far as I'm aware of. But I guess what I'm saying is, this is Jewish because it's focused on the Jewish state. But if it were on any other country, we would find it just as insane. And the fact that the United Nations is behind it is no surprise. Ben, last word to you. Have you had any feedback? You don't have to tell me what companies. You can keep that private. But have any of these companies acknowledged receipt of your briefing books or said thanks or said, oh, we didn't know about this? Have you had any feedback by potential shakedown targets of this BDS campaign?
Yes, in fact, we have. I'm proud to say, first and foremost, that we shared a somewhat shortened version of this analysis with several New York-based companies regarding specifically the New York human rights law. Essentially functions the same way. It says you cannot boycott based on national origin, among other protected classes. And we have been told that those, by the boards of those entities, that they successfully staved off attempts to implement BDS principles. We also have shared the full memo with several Fortune 500 companies. And as you noted, I'm not at liberty to mention which one by name, but yes, we were told by them that they brought it up at their meeting. They said, look at this analysis, look at all the laws that are implicated if we go forward with this. Of course we can't engage in any kind of boycott like this. Of course it would be irresponsible and dangerous to our own interests. This is done.
Isn't that interesting? Well, Benjamin Reiberg, we're big fans of the Lawfare Project. We love your support of freedom of speech against Islamic extremist lawfare, of which I myself have been a target, and it sounds like you're doing good work on this file. Hey, if you like that, sign up for my show every day. Click on the screen to subscribe.